14th Sunday in the Pentecost season. We begin our celebration on page 185 with the words of the grace, which draw us together into this body of Christ. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you all our hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
That you may heed the prayer that your servant prays towards this place, Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. O hear in heaven your dwelling place. Heed and forgive. Likewise, when a foreigner who is not of your people Israel comes from a distant land because of your name, for they shall hear of your great name, your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm. When a foreigner comes and prays towards this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all that the foreigner calls to you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and so that they may know that your name has been invoked on this house that I have built. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always preserve in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me, to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascend into where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one who would betray him. And he said, for this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father. Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, do you also wish to go away? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Churches use their power and authority to not just
with someone who has worked in the diocese, but that's not the case. I have seen colleagues who I would think of as the best people be revealed as quite the opposite. And we're warned that if we ignore these things, if we think that's something I don't want to hear about in church, or I don't want to hear about anywhere, that we allow evil to continue to have its hold. Because evil works in two ways in the church. It works to, in the first instance, hurt those who are directly affected. But then it goes on in the secondary way to hurt those who want to ignore it, cover it up, or forget about it. And by addition, it hurts the faith of those of us who come faithfully to church and want it to be a place of peace and joy and respite and worship and wonderful music. There aren't any guarantees that the church is a better place than the outside world. Solomon, in his prayer for his temple today, his great, beautiful temple, said, "Lord, I want you to guarantee that whenever anyone comes here to pray, you will hear what they say and respond." In the pieces that are absent from this long reading, he says, "And I want you to guarantee that if there's famine, pestilence, locusts, mildew, blight, plague, that if people come here to pray, you'll eradicate those too. And I want you to guarantee to me," he says, "that my family will get what you promised, that our family will go on forever." Well, we know God doesn't operate that way. We know that God doesn't give us those guarantees. We know that Solomon was the second last of his line, that in fact, after his son, the unified country that he was so proud of would fall apart because of his family's sins. God doesn't give us a guarantee that if we pray and in his temple and if we build a beautiful building, all will be well. Because we are fallen, sinful human beings. Our sin may not be direct, but our sin can be complicit if we refuse to think about evil or we try to cover it up. The hard saying for the disciples today was not that Jesus was the bread of life. The hard saying, the difficult saying, was that they had to become like Jesus in order to receive the kingdom of God. The hard saying wasn't that intellectually they couldn't make it make sense. It was that morally they had such a high standard to attain to. And many of them just gave up. And many Christians give up. We know that. Many Christians give up because they come to church wanting something from Jesus, like the Galileans did. But after they get the bread, after they get what they've asked for, they don't want to have to give anything back. Jesus' followers weren't interested in take up your cross and follow me. Those who will come after me will have to give up mother, father, sister, brother, and suffer. They thought, no, we just came for the bread, and this was a good time. But if there's bad times ahead, we're not interested. It's difficult to be a disciple of Jesus Christ in this time as it was in that time. The church in that time faced persecution. It faced people who were empowered with authority, lording it over the average Joe and pushing them out. And that's what Ephesians is talking about today. So what can we do? I'll tell you one thing. In all the work that I had to do with the diocese, I never faced as much opposition. And Susan is already laughing because she knows we're annoyed with this. I never faced as much opposition as telling people that we had a sexual misconduct policy that they had to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest. that if they wanted to hold a position of trust and authority in the church, they had to do what, Susan? They had to have a police records check. People's immediate response was, I'm an honest person. I'm a good person. I'm volunteering for this job. Why should I have to do that? Well, holding a position of power and authority and representing Jesus Christ in his church or in his community is not a given. It's not a gift. It's a privilege. It's a calling. It's a vocation. And our responsibility to the vulnerable people in our churches and in our society is to do everything we can as individuals and as a corporate structure to ensure that we have done everything that we can do to make the church a safe place for everyone. We can't undo things that have been done. And the letter to the Ephesians warns today, it's an ongoing battle. It wasn't back then, it isn't over, and it won't be over tomorrow. But we have to take on those things, put on that armor, use those tools that are available to us to make sure that we're proactive, that we're alert, that we're aware, that we are honest, that we are accepting the fact that evil is a presence. It's present in our church and in our world, and we ignore it at our peril. So we always have a choice. We can put on that full armor of God. We can wade into that battle, or we can ignore it and be on the side of evil. And that's as honest as I can be, because that's what I believe. We have the tools, we have the mental capacity, we have the intellect, do we have the will? That's what our society is asking the church now. And it's asking each one of us, not just a bishop, not just a priest, not just the person who's responsible for screening in our parish. He's asking each and every one of us, are we willing to be honest and open and real about the God we serve, fallen, evil, sinful people that we all are, and the requirements of discipleship? As the disciples say to Jesus today, where else can we go?
Throughout Western Canada, and the flooding, and mudslides throughout Asia. We pray for the sick and the suffering, remembering this week especially, when that same Peter Rhodes, Jim Bolton, Bill, Hillary, Ryan, Logan McCarty, Nicola, Dave, and Tyson Lindgren, and many others known to us. Let us ask the Lord to strengthen and relieve all those who are in need.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for the Church and the worldwide Anglican Communion this week, remembering the clergy of the Anglican Church of Southern Africa, Archbishop Thabo Mbeki. In the Diocese of Toronto, we pray for the Diocesan Council. And in our own parish cycle of prayer, we remember Mark, Aaron, and Christian Hawk, Diane and Kirk Hurd, Todd Hillhouse, and Chris McKay. We pray for our bishops, Colin, Andrew, and Peter, for our priests also. Let us ask the Lord to renew the Church through the power of his life-giving Spirit.
Lord, have mercy.
Gracious God, you've heard the prayers of your faithful people. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Grant our requests as may be best for us. Thus we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, my Lord.
We continue on page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done,
and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, and that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said to his disciples, my peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
true and perfect gift. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our Eucharistic prayer is prayer 2 on page 196.
Never thirst.
Thank you.
Increase in us the healing power of your love. Guide and direct us that we may please you in all things. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We conclude the parable on page 214. All your works praise you, O Lord.
And your faithful servants bless you. Gracious Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we who share his body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord.
Be steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and untiring in love all the days of your life. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love, here and in paradise, now and forever.
Amen.
Yes, Kirk.
Mike Dave's going to talk about September.
What?
No.
We didn't rehearse it.
Confusion in the ranks.
We didn't rehearse it.
Okay. Well, I will talk about that too then.
Oh.
I can't believe Kirk is shirking the opportunity to make an announcement. I fear change.
Well, I have a second announcement, but I thought Dave was going to do it first.
September the 7th is the parish corn roast. Only 2 weeks away. We're asking people to bring salads and desserts. There will be hot dogs, hamburgers, and corn. And a great night. We'll get going. I understand you have some old pictures.
I do.
Of parish life.
I do. I've been systematically going through our filing cabinets and getting rid of a lot of old stuff. I happen to come across a really large folder that has all kinds of old photographs and news articles. Not just at this church, but at the other parishes that formed this congregation. So I thought I would bring it out that evening, and we'll lay them all at the table, and I'm sure you'll see friends and neighbors, family members that you've kind of forgotten about. If there's any there that you would like to take home and keep as memorabilia, please do. It's been interesting. I can recognize some of the people, but not everybody. So we'll have like a parish memories table or something.
And if you think talking about September is bad, I want to mention something about Christmas.
Wow.
I started working this week on the Toys for Tots Christmas tree program we do each year. And I am in real need of someone who has some ability to make posters or signs or do internet stuff.
Someone artistic or
creative, yes. That's what I'm really lacking in my life. So if anybody is interested in teaming up with me on that, I will be asking individuals to do individual things, but that creative flair, I'm really short of. So if anybody has an interest in that, please speak to me over the next few weeks, and we'll, because I started advertising already, believe it or not, and getting people to sponsor our trees, so, yeah.
Yes, so you may know someone, maybe you have a family member who doesn't really come to church, but might be willing to lend their expertise in the artistic creative department. So if you can think of anybody like that, you could tap for a quick down and dirty project. Who would want to work with Kirk, right?
So
Jim's going to do some sign-up sheets for me in the hall next Sunday for desserts and volunteering and veggies and things like that. And yeah, we'll have a contest, hopefully Chris Cox doesn't win.
Bring one peach wrapping.
Yeah, bring peach wrapping circle.
All of Cole's won last year.
Yeah, all of Cole's won last year.
I know, and I have never won either, so I mean, that's...
It's not debate time, okay? It's just announcement.
What's my announcement?
You changed the price of the best cooked hamburger. Give it a chance.
I feel competition. doing his cooking skills, so I don't know. Also, well down the catalog, but do remember October 19th, we will be hosting a Jigs dinner. If you don't know what a Jigs dinner is, I'm not going to tell you, you better look it up. But we're doing it in conjunction with our friends at Trill United. It will be a dinner being held here, so watch for further info. And Sunday, October the 21st, is World Food Sunday. So I'll give you advance notice that we're going to be holding a massive food drive. Cards and cans, cash and cans for our local food bank. We're hoping to have a little friendly competition with our brothers and sisters at Trillium to see who can raise the most food cards and cash for our local food bank. And keep those items on your calendar and in your head as events coming up in the life of your church. Any other announcements not contained in the bulletin which need to be made? Going once.